The Lockheed L-1011 TriStar was undeniably one of the most advanced aircraft of its time. With modern avionics and increased automation, the aircraft could virtually land itself and could even safely approach runways under zero visibility conditions. The aircraft, however, nearly bankrupted the company that built it, alongside British engine manufacturer Rolls-Royce. Despite 250 jets ultimately completing construction and thus rendering the program far from a complete failure, Lockheed would never build a civilian airliner ever again and would stick almost exclusively to the defense space. On the other hand, there's the McDonnell Douglas DC-10, which was designed with similar engineering to the earlier DC-8 and was thus technologically far behind the L-1011 TriStar. Furthermore, the DC-10 had a problematic safety record and encountered a string of fatal crashes in the 1970s that damaged the aircraft's credibility. And so it would appear that the L-1011 was poised to succeed against its outdated and dangerous rival. Of course, for those who know about this chapter of aviation history, this was not in fact the case. Indeed, over 430 DC-10s were delivered to customers. In this video, we'll take a deeper look at what led the DC-10 to outsell the superior L-1011. When the Federal Aviation Administration, or FAA, enforced its 60-minute rule before the establishment of extended-range twin-engine operational performance standards, or ETOPS, twin jets were extremely limited in their capabilities on transoceanic routes. Quad jets, however, proved inefficient, as their heavy fuel consumption required them to be consistently full to profit. This created a small niche for trijets, as they would comply with the FAA's regulations by having more than two engines, but could also beat out the operating economics of the larger four-engine Boeing 747. Thus, both McDonnell Douglas and Lockheed raced to capture this market segment, ceding the top of the market to Boeing's successful jumbo jet. Lockheed even had a head start going into the battle to get both planes on the market. With development complete, the aircraft was to enter production in 1968. McDonnell Douglas would take another year to get production started on the DC-10. Despite this, Lockheed fell behind and did not deliver its first L-1011 until 1972, while McDonnell Douglas did so a year earlier in 1971. American Airlines was the launch customer for the DC-10, while Eastern Airlines was the first carrier to take delivery of the L-1011. According to a piece published in Time, Lockheed had been handcuffed by production delays at Rolls-Royce, which was the only manufacturer that offered to build engines for the L-1011's unique S-shaped duct concept. This S-duct design reduced the aircraft's drag and improved stability, while also reducing overall weight. As highlighted by Airline Reporter, Lockheed and Rolls-Royce both suffered through the development process of the RB211 engines that would power the TriStar. It's interesting to note that the selection of the RB211 for the TriStar made it the first foreign-made engine chosen as the basic power plant for a major US-built airliner, at least according to the Air and Space Museum. The Air and Space Museum adds that the RB211 differed from other engines in its class in having three instead of two shafts. This design permitted each compressor to run nearer its optimum speed and efficiency and reduced the number of blades and other parts required in the engine. McDonnell Douglas, on the other hand, went with the General Electric CF6, which was developed from the tried and tested TF39. The DC-10 beat the L-1011 to the market and advertised a high level of passenger comfort, dubbing the aircraft the luxury liner. This concept and marketing strategy was carried forward by airline customers, who were sure to use the term in marketing campaigns. And so, by the time the L-1011 got to customers, it was almost too late, as the DC-10 was able to edge out its rival on the order book. It may not have been just timing, however. Indeed, it's also notable that the Douglas side of McDonnell Douglas had a large existing commercial customer base, as it sold aircraft continuously from the 1940s. Aircraft like the DC-8 and DC-9 had been sold extensively around the world, making the DC-10 the natural choice for those operators looking to continue their relationship with McDonnell Douglas. On the other side, Lockheed's commercial and civilian passenger offerings were limited at the time. Indeed, the height of Lockheed's market penetration with aircraft like the Electra, Starliner, and Super Constellation were far in the past. Taking a step back to look at the bigger picture, it could also be argued that the trijet market was not big enough for either aircraft to truly thrive and become a bestseller. By the time ETOPS regulations came around and allowed efficient twin jets to cross over water, the trijet's high fuel consumption soon rendered it obsolete. But from a sales perspective, McDonnell Douglas made some smart moves. Despite its questionable early safety record, the aircraft would prove over time to be just as safe as most other aircraft of the era. Not only did they get their aircraft to customers sooner, but the manufacturer also designed a second life for the jet as an aerial tanker, and the company sold 60 KC-10 extender planes, which were operated by the US Air Force. Lockheed, however, got unlucky with production delays at Rolls-Royce. Nonetheless, the L-1011 would go on to serve some of America's biggest airlines for the next few decades, including Delta, United, Eastern, TWA, and Pan Am. Across the pond, British Airways was also a major operator of the TriStar. Unfortunately, the jet was simply built too slowly and targeted a market that was just not big enough to justify its high development costs. These days, you'll find both types of aircraft still flying, although the L-1011 is much more difficult to spot, as there appears to be just one still active. Taking data from planespotters.net, the single active TriStar is operated by Northrop Grumman as the Pegasus Air Launch Platform. Known as the Stargazer, the aircraft carries a Pegasus rocket which is launched at altitude to further propel satellites up into low Earth orbit. For the DC-10, airframes are still active as aerial refuelers and aerial firefighters. While their military equivalents, the KC-10, are on their way out of the US Air Force, the modified DC-10s operated by private contractor Omega Aerial Refueling Services will continue to be used for in-air refueling. As aerial firefighters, the firm known as 10 Tanker Air Carrier deploys its fleet of 4 DC-10s across the world to assist in the control of large wildfires. Did you ever get a chance to step on board a McDonnell Douglas DC-10 or Lockheed TriStar L-1011? Share your experiences by commenting below. Simple Flying publishes over 150 articles every week. If you're looking for the latest aviation news and insights, visit simpleflying.com.